barrel.
Hello, boys and girls of the internet. It's me, Vince, also known as... Hello, boys and girls. It's me, Vince, also known as PleasantKenobi on the internet. And I'm here to give you another vlog of sorts. So I'm going to call it Vlog-atog from now on, which I'll come to in a moment. I am sorry for no content this week since last game to upload. I still plan to upload a piece of gameplay every 2 weeks, as I've described before in the last vlog. I've just been really busy. We started D&D recently, and I started exercising. So trying to fit that onto a regime where I also get to make the additional content is difficult. I've also spent the whole weekend in Wales getting pissed up for a stag do. Got punched in the head by the groom's brother, so I've got a bit of a bruise in the side of my head here. All in good fun though, he was just being a Larry bastard. So more gameplay coming next weekend. I won't spoil exactly what I'm doing, but it's an old favourite with a new card from Hour of Devastation. I won't give you too big a clue, but let's just say I'll be slithering onto my channel come sort of Saturday, Sunday of next week. And the vlogs are called Vlog-atogs now, because A, Mark Rosewater calls his vlog the Vlog-atog, so I thought I would call my vlog the Vlog-atog. And two, it gets stronger every time someone sacrifices their own dignity and self-worth to me. So this time I'm vlogging from my office, despite it being a lovely day outside, just because I'm really, really tired after that stag do. So this is where all the online magic happens, and this week I'll be hitting up a modern FNM as well. I haven't played paper magic in about 2 months. I took a little bit of a hiatus just to try and reignite my love of the game a little bit by just sort of stepping back and enjoying myself more than trying to play any sort of competitive games. So I'll let you know how I get on with that as well. But I asked you last week some questions because I got to the 2k, 3k sort of subscriber mark and thought I'd celebrate the occasion by asking some questions, and I'd answer them. I've now hit 4,000, so I've actually kept that growth going. I've just started to slow down now. But let's go ahead and answer some questions from you, the fans, the ones that, you know, tickle me from below. Actually, a lot of you didn't ask much, you just told me how great you found the channel and how much you enjoyed the content, so yeah, keep doing that. Just keep stroking my ego, like a lover would stroke a penis. Yeah, that's it. Keep it up. Get it? Do you get it? Keep it up? Aiden Dimitru asks, where did you get the 4p to 5p thing from? Also, does it dribble regardless sometimes? And if so, I am concerned. So that's two questions to start off there. To answer the first, I think it came from something one of my best friends, Big Carl, said. Big Carl was in the Chicken Nugget Challenge video, if you watched that. He was the one who absolutely demolished it like a fucking fiend. He has a lot of weird colloquialisms that he picks up from, I don't know, market traders and plumbers around how to refer to genitalia. One of my other favourites is that he refers to the arsehole as a balloon knot, because both of them look exactly the same when viewed up close. I think I need to clarify the 5p to 50p thing. I think where it came from was when Carl was referring to his arsehole as being the size of a 20p piece. I made the joke because it's not that the hole itself is the size of a 50p, it's that the whole like surface area of that chocolate starfish, the discoloured area around the knot as it were, is the size of a 50p, and then when you clench it becomes smaller, like puckered, like a pursed lip where it tightens and sort of hides itself from the world. So in order to answer the second question, no, it doesn't just fall out of my arse, even despite my chronic IBS ruining my life. Mitchell Ryan said, hey man, I honestly am fairly new to modern, but your B deck brought me so much happiness that I honestly had to go and buy the deck, and I was wondering where you found the deck and what made you play it. Okay, well, the idea of calling for a Hornet's Nest with Purpose in play was just some really janky brew I played back in Standard, back when all those cards were legal. I love both Nest and Purphoros, so it was ideal to put them into a deck where I had Cord to search up, you know, key toolbox creatures. It wasn't very good. I think I went 2-2 at an FNM, and that was kind of it. I retired the deck. Then me and John the Baptist sort of birthed Mono Redtron in the back of a car on the way home from a PPTQ. And we came up with the idea of just blowing up stuff in the Blasphemous Attacks and killing people by casting big mana stuff thanks to the Tron lands. And then we sort of were brewing and chatting in our super friends group chat on Facebook and just sort of got to the point where we were like, actually, what if we battle to a Hornet's Nest? And then I was like, oh, I'll throw Purphoros in because I remember that combo being good. And since then, I'd enjoyed Impact Tremors in Khans of Tarkir and with the mono red deck that you could Hordling Outburst and Stoke the Flames people and stuff like that. So yeah, that's kind of where the deck came from, really. It was a natural progression from a crappy standard deck I had, channeled through Mono Red Tron to come out the other end of the glorious green red B combo deck that people seem to fucking love. And it's just a lot of fun, so I'm really glad that people are enjoying it. And that's kind of its origin story, really. Not as fun as being bit by a radioactive spider or having your parents killed in a crime alley, but you know, not all superheroes have to have a tragic beginning. Vexial, he has a few questions, so let's have a look. So question one, how did I first get into magic? Well, an older kid on my block taught me. He was an older kid who pretended to be way cooler than he was. My parents hated him. He had a picture of Gail Porter with her tits out on his wall, and he used to pretend that he got drunk when he probably did it. He was probably like 12, 13 at the time. So it's around 98, 99, he lent me some cards and taught me how to play. So these cards, played with some other kids and didn't know what I was doing. Then eventually he taught me. I remember Denizen the Deep was the Gorn card he kept going on about being the biggest creature ever made, and it's going to be, he's going to get one and wreck everyone with it. And I looked it up, and that card came out in the starter set of 98. It was his first printing, I believe. So yeah, we're looking at like 98 to 2000, somewhere around then. So I was no older than 10. After that, I played kitchen table magic with a lot of the boys you saw in the Chicken Nugget video and some close friends, and we sort of didn't really buy any cards. Big Carl, of course, bought cards because Big Carl will splash the cash if it means he can get some more gash. So yeah, and then Eventide was when I first played my first draft. So that's how I got into magic. Any thoughts about streaming your gameplay on Twitch or the like? Well, I streamed about a year ago. We had quite a good showing and some regulars, which was really cool. The problem is it's very time consuming and a lot of effort, and I tried to get some moderators in as well, like John the Baptist and Chris as well, part of the Super Friends, but it takes a lot of time and effort, and you don't really want to do that unless you're getting the reward from it. And YouTube feels instantly more gratifying because I've got more analytics to look at, likes, dislikes, watch time, watches, subscribers, where Twitch didn't really have that for me. And I wasn't even getting as much response from Twitch as I was from YouTube at the time. We got 100 viewers on one of the last streams we did, which was really fun and quite exciting. So I want to go back to it, but maybe perhaps when I've built up the channel and the Facebook page and stuff now, so that I've got a bit of a following to come and watch, because it's boring if you don't do it with the regulars and stuff. So I'm probably going to hit 5,000 subs or more, maybe somewhere between 5 and 10, maybe about 7-ish, and that's when I'll start streaming again, I think. I'm thinking of streaming on YouTube. I don't think many magic streamers stream on YouTube, so I won't be competing for space and time, although... Oh, well, we'll be competing for space with Numut the Nummy and stuff still, but... not space, because there's a whole new area to explore. It also doesn't divide you guys, so you guys will know when I'm live, so you can come and watch and hang out and stuff, as opposed to Twitch, where I've got to get you guys set up for email notifications for another service and things. If we can keep it all in one place, I think we'll build a better community, essentially. So let me know in the comment section below, would you like to see me stream? And would you object to be on YouTube, or do you think it'd be better to stream via Twitch? Let me know below. What is the main thing you do for fun outside of magic? So aside from sexing my wife and walking my dog, I love video games. So I own pretty much all of the consoles that exist at the moment. Switch, Xbox One, PS4, I've got a gaming PC that I built recently to play on Battlegrounds, which I'm hoping to make some videos about soon. So yeah, I started making videos about video games on YouTube, and they just weren't successful because there's too many people making like video game content, and I wasn't unique enough, where at least with Magic I found my unique niche and an angle that is different to everyone else, I think. So that's my other like sort of big hobby. I've got video game themed tattoos. I mean, I've got like Foxhound there, because Metal Gear Solid is one of my favourite things. Half-Life 2 is one of my favourite games as well. But on top of that, I play Dungeons & Dragons once a week now again. I played it weekly for about 4 years, 3 to 4 years, with a good friend of mine called Rob, who's been on the channel before in some of the gameplay videos early on when we first built Death and Taxes. So I'm playing that again with the boys, Big Carl, Big Dean, Big Phil. And I also play X-Wing miniatures, like, casually. I just fucking love Star Wars, but when I played my first tournament, I got completely wrecked. And I don't want to get deep into another game like I am with Magic. I think I want to keep some things, you know, casual, I guess. Squizzy asked me, what is the strangest or wackiest deck you ever played? And I guess a simple answer to that is either Mono-Red-Tron or Red-Green Bees, because not only are they weird and wacky and a little bit out there, they also seem to be such a meme that other people responded to it and sort of gravitated towards it and sort of internalised it and started loving it as well. So yeah, I think they are the weirdest decks that I've played. Brigadier Prime asked me how many card sleeves I could stick up my ass. I reckon I could fit 62. No more, no less. I'd have to be 62. If I put too few up there, it wouldn't pack it out and they'd probably fall out. But if I put too many in there, I'd probably just shit myself. So I'm going to go with 62 as a safe number. He asked me, green red beef or blue white chicken? I'm going to go with green red beef because I like a spicy meatball, and the idea of eating blue chicken makes me want to fucking kill myself. And number three, he asked me, do puppies have Christmas? Of course they have Christmas, you mad bastard. A long time fan of the channel, Dennis Crenshaw, asked me, how does one keep that beard in shape? A steady regimen of chin-ups, or does the stiff upper lip of the British help with it? I believe it's fueled and maintained by my inherent manliness. I am so manly and so up to the fucking balls of testosterone that it just seeps out of my pores, and then it solidifies into physical beard hair, chest hair, and just latent sexiness. Jason Kirkner, or Kirkner? I mean, I've saved the image too low to be able to read it properly. I'm sorry, mate. Asked me, as he's a recent sub, he said he's really enjoying the content that isn't in full serious mode. So, yeah, I'm glad you're enjoying the sort of the... well, that's basically me. And he hit the channel because of my D&T video. So he asked me, when did I get my start in Magic and do I play competitively? I've already answered the starting sort of thing without going into the competitive side of stuff. But yeah, I started playing drafts at Eventide and pre-releases and all that sort of stuff. And I started playing GPs maybe a year or two after that. Maybe around Dark Ascension was my first English GP. Then I started playing really regularly, playing PVTQs, GPTs, GPs. I played 5 GPs last year, all across Europe. 2 in England and the rest in the mainland Europe. I vlogged the mainland Europe ones, so you guys can find them on the channel. I'll link to a playlist at the end of this video with those vlogs on them. I think they're quite good, I think they're quite funny. So check those out if you want to see some of that. And I will be playing in at least one English GP this year. Unfortunately, a friend of mine's getting married on the modern one, so I won't be there for the main event. I will be there for the day 2, I think. And then I'll drive down to Birmingham, hopefully with John the Baptist, and just come play some side events, maybe meet some people. So if you want to meet up or come say hello, I'll get some cards signed, come let me know and I'll meet you down in Birmingham. Yeah, and then hopefully maybe Lille later in the year. I still need to convince some guys to go to that. That's Unified Team Modern. So Taylor and John or Chris or someone, to get some people involved with that. So yeah, I love competitive Magic and I really want to get out of the Pro Tour one day, but I just don't know if I'm good enough. But I'm enjoying myself making stupid fucking videos on the internet, so let's stick to that for now, shall we? Isaac Banner, who's a long-time viewer and regular commenter, asked me, are you still lazy and do you still hate yourself? Which is a reference to a repeated line of self-deprecating jokes in one of my other videos. Whilst the recognition and the growth of the channel has helped, I'm often still filled with doubts around my own abilities and legitimacy, basically. It's weird to talk about something like Magic when I've got no, like, sort of Pro Tour places under my belt. I'm not the Travis Wu who's got the proven track record of success. On the other hand, I've never said Hitler was right either, so I guess, you know, we've all got things going for something with Travis. But yeah, I'm often filled with doubts that I'm doing the right thing, I'm doing things that are worth my time, your time, whether people will even care or watch. I didn't have very successful videos initially on YouTube with the typical cookie-cutter Let's Play video game stuff I was doing. Some of them are cringe where we look back on, but I won't get rid of them because they're part of my history, what's made me who I am today. So yeah, sometimes I do still hate myself, but the love of a good woman and some family and friends and some nice recognition on the internet will help you feel a lot better about yourself, so yeah. And laziness, no, I'm motivated when I've got a positive response from the local community, like you guys. I say local, half of you are from Brazil apparently, according to my analytics, so. Well, I was gonna say hi in Portuguese then, but I don't know what hi in Portuguese is, and I'm too deep in the recording to go Google it, so. Hello! That wasn't even a Portuguese accent, I'll stop. Andrew Ryan says, Colin Farrell. Well, I guess the answer to this question is yes, of course. You know, Colin Farrell. Colin Farrell. Colin Farrell. Colin Farrell. Bun Bros asks, my question is, how did you practice or learn how to speak for YouTube in both being witty and not sound like a bumbling mess? I guess it comes somewhat naturally to me, as I've always been quite good at talking to people, and I'm quite an outgoing person, so I'm like naturally quite outspoken. So a camera or an audience come naturally because I don't talk back, so you can be as self-absorbed and as center of attention as you want. I've also been working in retail all my working life, bars, shops. I'm a failed teacher, which is probably a story for another time. So speaking in front of people has always been quite easy as well, because I've just been there and had the chance to practice and learn. But just give it a go, keep trying, and if it doesn't come naturally, just make use of the editing process. Right now I've made mistakes that I've cut out that you won't see, so just do that. Talk to a camera, give it a go, edit it down to as compact as you can be. Don't be too self-indulgent with your ramblings like I am. And yeah, give it a shot if you want to get into it. Adolf Hipster says, what is your favourite deck to play besides Mono Red Tron? And P.S. I love your beard. I like your moustache too, but perhaps not your policies on you know, democracy and stuff. That's probably the easiest question yet, because Death and Taxes is my favourite thing ever. In both Modern and Legacy, it's got it's mono white aggression, it's got controlling elements, it's got flickering, it's got land destruction, it's got fucking Grimaz and Thalia and all the coolest fucking cards ever printed. Equipment. I mean, in Legacy, equipping a Mirror and Crusader with a Sword of Fire and Ice. That's fucking... And then, Aether Bar. Aether Bar just makes every card better. It turns Flicker Whisper into an absolute fucking house. So yeah, there's no choice about it. Death and Taxes is easily my favourite deck across the Eternal formats. And if I can get to play in other formats like Cube and stuff, I'll try. If you haven't seen any of the gameplay of Death and Taxes before on the channel, they are in the Hot and Sexy playlist that I've put up of all this sort of similar gameplay style with the humour that I've put up. So I'll link to that at the end of the video, so be sure to check that out as well. And then we'll come to our last question of today. So we got Drew Harmon, who asks, it's not a question about my dog or my beard, but what process do I use to record and edit Magic Online gameplay? How long does it take? Do you ever notice major mistakes in gameplay and edit them out so no one ever notices your shame? I either record the game as I was playing or record the replays after the fact if the replay feature of MTGO is not being completely shit. If you've seen the last video, you'll see that I actually had to sort of fucking put aside the video that I'd already wanted to make with the replays that I'd already gathered and had to go out and play more fucking practice rooms to find more games because the replay feature is bugged as usual on Chord or Python Needle or some other shit. What I record with is a program called Action. So Google like Action Video Recording. It's not free, but it's really good. The video quality is high, the tools are very simple and easy to use. It's got multiple modes, and screenshot, I can save audio, I can do webcam at the same time. And the file sizes are nice and small, relatively speaking, as well, compared to things like Fraps and other crap I've tried in the past. I will then stick that into Movie Studio. I've got Movie Studio 13 or 14, let's have a look. And then I will look through the footage and make notes about things I think will be funny, stuff I want to say, and just points about the games. And then I will go through and flesh that out into a real script with actual jokes. I will then record that. It used to be on a microphone, but that broke, so I now record on this camcorder I'm using now, and then rip the audio. So I do need to build and buy a proper microphone because people are complaining. A few people complain about the audio quality, so I will do that soon. I then put that into Movie Studio. I compact it all down so the audio, so it's what the sort of master track, getting away with all the stuttering and incorrect phrases and jokes and coughs and farts and splutters. And then I will then edit the footage onto that. And then splice in all the visual jokes, essentially. This whole process can take anywhere between 5 and maybe upwards of 10 hours, depending on the video, complexity, amount of games we're playing, and sort of how over the top some of the visual jokes are. So the opening, sort of like moving around the map of how we come to the Dragon Ball B's name, took me like 2 or 3 minutes to put it together and paint. But then it took me maybe half an hour to actually sort of write the script to fit it properly, to refit it properly, and then another further like half an hour to just move the camera around and stuff, and then fit that all together in sequence together. So that bit alone probably took me well over almost 2 hours. So yeah, maybe I'm slow, I get distracted as well. I'll start looking at Magic the Gathering memes on Instagram when I should be editing. So, but yeah, that's the general process of it. So that's it for this week's self-indulgent foray into the mind and life of Vince, also known as Pleasant Kenobi on the internet. If you want to know anything else or anything more, then please feel free to drop me some more comments with some more questions. I might do another Q&A answer video. And back to the main question that I sort of it's got me thinking is, do you guys want to see me stream? If you want to see me stream, then, you know, post in the comments below. Again, the question is Twitch or YouTube, and we'll go from there. And then I'll be vlogging each week like I have done now, and then we'll be gameplay every 2 weeks as per usual. In the meantime, if you haven't subscribed, make sure you fucking subscribe because it makes my dick really hard. And go over to Facebook, to Pleasant Kenobi. I've made a sort of Facebook page where I'm posting like links and stuff that I find interesting, questions about how to keep on worlds. I've asked people what their genitals make the noise of when they're excited, like mine hums off the computer. But yeah, in the meantime, peace out. And click some of the links that come up on screen now. And I'm just going to sit here for a little bit, not really doing anything, just sort of murmuring on. The video will probably fade out at this point, but I'll keep the stuff on screen so you can click it. If I had something like a dildo, I'd wave that around now, but I don't.